There are so many private colleges. Believe me, the other system, which is the university system in this country, is highly neglected. And we have 357 universities, each having so many affiliated colleges, ranging from anywhere 50 to 500 colleges. And still, these universities do not get the amount of funding. These are also higher educational institutions, which they require. And the government, what is the job of the government? Government is doing sort of equidistribution, the socialistic attitude. That is, give everybody little, 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 and let them do what they want to do. That is not the way to fund higher education. Higher education should also be funded on selective basis. Where there is talent, there is motivation, there is innovation, they must be projected, they must be funded to the fullest extent. And once, because success is atticadalytic, remember, that once you are successful, if the institution is successful, the industry also wants to go and put money in that institution. So there are many examples in this country where entrepreneurs have been generated out of the research institution, research done by those students in their own institution. And to say that we are not doing enough, remember our country has so many colleges. We produce about 5 lakh of engineering graduates, but we cannot employ even 10% of those graduates. What is the use of that degree? The problem is that what we learn is not related to what we want to do. Because, you know, somebody said, Dr. Sonde said some time back, and everybody wants to be in IT, whether he's a mechanical engineer, civil engineer, or something else, he wants to be an IT engineer. So what is he learning for those, that particular 4 years of education? It is related to only money, comfort, luxury. Do they want to be rich overnight, or do they want to have a satisfaction for the entire life? So we'll find that today's kids are all confused because of this money market. There is nothing more than that. And so when we talk about funding of allied institutes of higher education, we must also think that we have to create innovation in each and every field. It is not just one field. Otherwise, the nation cannot grow. So whether it is mechanical engineering, civil engineering, electrical, chemical, name it, you have to have innovation. And for that, we do require industrial partnership. And as I mentioned earlier, you know, our country produces only about 750 PhDs in engineering. What we need is almost 7,000 PhDs. And where are you going to get it? Unless people are motivated to do research and do innovation. Remember, any country's GDP is dependent on the number of PhDs the country produces in engineering and technology. And this is very well correlated with the PhDs produced by United States, Japan, Italy, Netherlands, France, UK, and there is a fantastic correlation. We produce about 750 PhDs. Our per capita income is only that much, $750. Okay, per person income. Okay, and you go to United States, 35,000 PhDs, their income is $35,000. So it just somehow it correlates with that. Why it correlates? Because they are innovators. When you go to PhD, when you do a PhD, even if your teacher is PhD or doing PhD, he knows the value of innovation. And that some of this innovation can be put into practice. Then he learns how to take risk. So this is very, very important. The other thing which is very important is the role of alumni in bringing money. In Western world, almost each and every college is supported by alumni. In fact, this is not happening in our country. We just, you know, like Dr. Sonde might come here and give a lecture. How much he has helped your institution? You ask him. Okay. So, I'm sorry to you. No, and Arun also, Arun. Yeah, so he's, what I mean to say is that when they have seen it themselves, the state of affairs in their own mother institutions, when they learnt it, I'm sure it was not rosy, as rosy is today. They should feel immediately that something should be done for their alma mater. If they are not going to do, nobody else is going to do. You cannot go to industry unless you start charity at home. In United States, believe me, every alumnus contributes at least 10% of his salary to many of these big institutions, so-called private universities and all. In fact, there are endowments where the students will donate anonymously. the undergraduate students approach their alumni to get these resources, and that is how the funds are built. So once you have those funds, you don't depend on government, then you can do wonders to your institution. You know, you can have a very cozy hall here, you can attract students, because that is what is important. In United States, another thing happens, which is like a religion. People contribute to their churches 10% of the salary. They do it lifelong. In fact, because they take religion is very big. And same time, they also think education is very big. Therefore, they contribute to that also. In our country, we might go to deity, maybe might go to Tirupati or wherever. We are ready to spend lakhs of rupees. But if I keep a, you know, thaila here and say, bring and please put your money, I will not be able to do it. I think, hey, I'm wasting my money. But I'm ready to waste it on floral bouquets and whatnot, but I'm not ready to spend that money on education. So higher education, unless you have all the equipment, all the necessary infrastructure, it cannot be taken to a higher level. We have to involve, and believe me, why we are not doing innovation? Because undergraduate students do not have projects on innovation or research. There should be a component of undergraduate research. Let out of that 100 projects, one or two be successful. Entire country, look at the number of engineering and technology colleges are there. It is not just limited to them, I must say that. That we will have enormous number of projects which can be taken to a higher level. They can be funded. And then comes the question of, you know, management and all other things. But unless you have an innovative idea, it cannot be done by any other means. Another important thing is that if we are talking about higher education, what about the salary of the poor teachers? Are they paid well? So what happens in many of these private colleges, last year's student becomes this year's teacher. And vice versa. So you have shared the room, maybe hostel, and enjoyed in the campus, and next year he comes to the class and starts teaching. See, you may have admiration, but you lose immediate respect for that person because you know that he was whiling away his time, he didn't get a job, and therefore he's there. That's what you believe. That's what you believe. So I think that situation needs to be changed by hiring the best talent, giving them much higher salaries. Then only the country can progress. With just 4% income spending on higher education, or total education for that matter, higher education takes very little of that. In fact, science and technology, or P. Chidambaram has budgeted $5 billion for next year, 2007-2008. That money is not sufficient, although it is 21% higher than last year's budget. But it is not sufficient. So I do believe that unless we fund institutions across the board, okay, and bring them to a certain status, we are not going to be the world leaders. And if we want to be world leaders, we always take example of China. China has instituted so many different departments and universities, and so much of money is put in there that you will be amazed to know that I believe in next few years there may be a Chinese Nobel laureate, but there will not be an Indian Nobel laureate. I'm sorry to say this, because we are saddled with all these bureaucratic delays and, you know, having total apathy for higher education. If I say if IIT Bombay is doing well, I will be very happy, because it is an institution I should be proud of. If any IIT brand name is selling, if UICT is doing well, producing so many good students and entrepreneurs, I'm very happy about it. But can we repeat this model somewhere else? And for that, we have to analyze these institutions. What is different in those institutions? Why individuals are doing better than somewhere else? They are allowed free consultation. They can go to industry. So I don't depend on my salary in my institute. I, in fact, return my salary to the institute because the mechanism allows me to earn more money than I can get in the industry. So I'm very happy. So I'm doing my teaching, I'm doing my research, doing my consultation. And that model could be replicated in all other process, provided we respect those institutions. We cannot deride them. See, we have two types of people in this country. We always, you know, crib about spending money on IITs. We always say they are going abroad. But we are not realizing that the same guys are now going to repay. And I think Professor Phatak is going to create some 500 crore rupees of funds. The same guys are going to give him, not the localites, but those who went abroad and earned that money. So I believe that we have to change our mindset. One, we have to be innovative. Number two, we have to take risks. Number three, we have to...